Thank you for gracing this session. I'll try and make it 20 minutes exactly. My name is Edwin, as Jax has mentioned, Edwin Kang’ethe, and I coordinate the mNutrition project under the captive unit and food safety and services. I'm trying to avoid that because I'm not tall enough. So basically today's presentation is capacity development through mobile technology. We're going to see or to look at how we can apply, how we apply mobile technology into development. And this is a capacity area for us as ILRI. So that is the focus of our presentation. The structure is as follows. I'll begin with a bit of introduction of the project. Then I'll take us through what we call mobile VAS value chain. So I inserted the word value chain there because it's familiar within ILRI. But mobile VAS basically is where our output of this project, where is it structured out there? It's under a product called VAS, and I'll explain a bit more on that when I get there. Then we'll define who are we working for. And as ILRI, we have a farmer that we're working for, and we'll attempt to define this farmer. And then we'll see a few successes that we have achieved up to now. And then have a look at what are we taking home as ILRI in terms of this program, and what lessons are we drawing from the program as an institute. So the project is a three-year project. We began honestly last year, 2014, and we expected it to be done by 2016. So 2017, we'll be publishing our successes, you know, making sure that everybody out there knows what we've been doing and what we have succeeded in doing. The program is structured in two programs. The project is structured in two programs. We have mHealth, so we have a mobile health component within the mNutrition or mobile nutrition project. And basically mHealth means that the output that we are drawing from this project is our health outputs. So we are talking about taking advantage or intervening within the first 1,000 days of a baby. So from the point of inception, so the point of the mother getting pregnant and the baby getting to 2 years. These are the 4,000 days, and that's the focus of this arm of the project, which is the mHealth. So this is about infant and child feeding, maternal, newborn, and child health. All that we encompass that, or we take care of that under the mHealth program. We have the second bit of the project, which is more relevant to us as ILRI. And that's the mAgri arm of the project. So mAgri, you're working towards agricultural products that are nutrition sensitive, that will help our farmers. So we want to impact at the household level. We want to impact the nutrition status of our farmer and his household through these products that we are working towards, or we're working in as this project. And these are products that are, in this case, mobile service products, so SMS, voice messages, and we'll see this a lot as we go on with the presentation. That is the goal of the overall outcome of the project, to improve nutrition through services that influence behavior change. So we want to send content to a farmer through their mobile phone to impact on some of the things they do around farming and around feeding. So to change their behavior towards enhanced nutrition outcomes within the household. And this, like I mentioned, we're doing through services that will be delivered as mobile services. That is the coverage of the project. So the project is a huge investment that we are implementing in partnership with other organizations. And in Africa, we are in 8 countries, and in Southeast Asia, we have 4 countries as listed there. So the way the project is structured is that we have five organizations. So ILRI, and then we have CABI as the leading partner in the consortium, and then we have BMJ, Oxfam, and GAIN. And we have distributed this amongst ourselves. We have divided amongst ourselves these countries. So ILRI, apart from several outputs that cut across all the countries, we specifically are implementing in Kenya, Uganda, and Pakistan as ILRI. So we are leading all the activities, project activities in those countries. But we have other outcomes or outputs, other working areas that ILRI is leading across the consortium. Those are training, and we will see where the training comes in, and also quality assurance of content or these outputs or these messages that I'm talking about or referring to. Let's go into mobile VAS. We are done with the introduction, brief introduction. So VAS stands for Value Added Services, and I preferred to leave it as VAS because out there it's referred as VAS. You'll never find it written in full as Value Added Services. And VAS for you is is the email that you have on your phone, on your smartphone. So that is a VAS service. Or a message that comes from someone to come from some campaign, for instance. It could be a Black Friday campaign. It could be a health campaign. In our case, we have agri campaign. So we are calling those messages campaigns that are, in most cases, delivered under what we call USSD technology, where you dial hash of a few numbers and then star a few numbers and then hash, and you get a menu of stuff. That is VAS. So that is value-added services. They are called value-added because the major revenue or the primary revenue for mobile networks is usually voice. So when mobile started, we all used it for voice. But then today we have a lot of other add-ons that we are utilizing, like you go on social media, you go on Twitter, you go on Facebook, and any when you want to, for instance, book a flight, you go on TripAdvisor and all that. Those are value-added services that initially were not there. And mobile networks are only in them because they add value to the voice, which is their primary investment, and that's where they get their most revenue. So the value chain of VAS, because our outputs as messages and voice will be sent to farmers as VAS, but we need to understand that value chain from where we are to the point where the farmer is reading that message on crop husbandry or animal husbandry. We'll begin here as content owner. You gotta start with content. You have something that you're sending to our farmers. And that's the content owners. And these are very different from the carriers or the mobile network operators. So you start at content owners where you go through your dig through your books and all that, and some and have whether it's health and or agri content. And then you have these guys that we call them the VAS aggregators. So these guys, they aggregate all those value-added services. It could be ringtones, the ringback ringtones, the ones you put in your phone, when I call you, I get some nice songs. Those are ringback tones. So there's a myriad of VAS content, and we have organizations that are call themselves aggregators that usually host that content for you. So as a content owner, you don't send direct your content to John, the farmer here. You will need a content management system, a plug and play where you, for instance, if you're sending content to farmers, big farmers in Uganda, and you want to send content around some big husbandry, like, I don't know, maybe a safety issue, like cleaning the big area, then you need to just press a button. That's the confidence you need as a content owner. You want a plug and play system. You just click a button and the farmer receives the information. Whatever happens in the back end is, you know, you don't need to take care of that. You don't need to think about that. So that's what these guys do. So they are a commercial organization, and usually a revenue share between aggregators and carriers to get your content to join our farmer here. Then from there, the content goes through a network, and then to John. And this other end here, we have, you have your handset here.
And then you have the operating system that sort of like, I think everybody here should be able to familiar, you know what an operating system is, like Windows for your computer. So we have all this operating system for your devices, these smartphones. You have Android, iOS for Apple products. You have Symbian, Windows for Microsoft products, and all that. Handset vendors. Some go through the carrier. So they are in most Western, in a lot of Western countries, you find that there are carriers that have sort of like Verizon. They have their own. They have agreements with handset vendors, and they brand those handsets, such that you cannot use another network on that handset. But they, in these parts of the world and the areas that we work, developing world, we have this direct relationship. Now, this is where ILRI is working, content development. So we are not concerned with a lot of these other areas of the value chain. We are only implementing around content development. But we are also in conversations with all these other members of the value chain to ensure that this product that we're developing eventually ends up in a farmer's phone. Because if you don't do that, then you have content, but you've not defined a structure to get that content to join. So we will refer to this in the other bits of the presentation. Let's define our farmer or the guys that we target with our outputs within the project. We have John here. And John is, these are the things that John struggles. These are the challenges that John has. How do I get extension services? He never gets those. Farm inputs and implements, what to use where, what fertilizer, what type of seed is best for my soil and all that. What season, when should I sow, when should I harvest, how do I preserve my harvest, you know, that kind of stuff. These are things and many more that our farmers are struggling with. And so these are the things that we want to intervene in when we bring projects such as the mNutrition project. When we think about John and his inputs and implements, because lack of information on these things is what makes John a small scale holder who has very little from his farm, who gets very little from his enterprises, whether they are livestock or crop enterprises. When we look at the inputs and implements, you probably will come up with a list like mine here. It's not exhaustive, but you can exhaust it. But you're not likely to include mobile as an input or as an implement for John. And that's what we are doing with the project. That for us, mobile is as good an implement for John as this hoe or jeeper is. And how is that? We've highlighted these challenges, and we are saying within the project, we've seen that mobile has this potential to bridge that gap of information that John is struggling with, so that John can access, for instance, weather forecast via mobile, can get messages around animal husbandry, market prices for his pigs, what are the improved seeds and where can he get them. So all that stuff can be accessed through the mobile. Why didn't we go for radio or TV? Because we are looking, from where we are standing, mobile is an enabler for us for behavior change communication. It's purely an information bridging tool. Mobile and the opportunity that it brings for us that other technologies are not is that GSM cover. GSM is the technology that allows you to operate your mobile phone. So it stands for Global System for Mobile Communication. Again, I avoided defining it in full because you never find it. You always find it as GSM. So GSM coverage in emerging markets like Africa and Asia, poorer nations that we are working in, is 80%, 85%. So this is way higher than you get, for instance, the landline or TV or radio. And that's why for us this was a bullseye technology to adopt. Another thing that is coming up in these emerging markets is that access for mobile services is equal in urban and rural. You're finding it very, very close. Unlike other technologies where you find them in a lot of them in urban areas, but rural areas struggle with them. In the case of mobile, it's almost equal. So you, and I'm sure you can also attest to this, you can call someone in Pokot or Turkana, Marsabit, from here in Nairobi, and they'll pick just as good as you're calling somebody in Kilimani or Westlands here. So it's this is a big deal for the success of this information-based tool. The ownership base of what we are calling smartphones, or phones that go beyond a voice, so phones that have other services that you can use, is about 1.9 billion globally. And that is about one in four persons having a smartphone. Of course, we have a few hippies who have two or three, and therefore this is not really a good, an excellent number to use, but it's still an incredible figure for smartphones, and we can't turn away from this. And these smartphones, you have your smartphone because you want to use it, you use your phone beyond voice. VAS, this is what you're calling VAS, value-added services. You have ringtones and all that fancy stuff, emails, but for a farmer we have products that you want to deliver by what you call the VAS. The difference between difference between smartphone and a feature phone is that feature phone a very basic phone. What a feature phone was in, for instance, 5 years ago is not the same as a feature phone today. Today's feature phones will have emails and all that, but you'd have to access those via browsers. And probably some of us remember that time when you would have to access your email via a browser within your phone that you thought was smart. So that is still a feature phone. But basically the basic thing is that the operating system within that cannot be edited. You cannot code to that system. So you cannot, it doesn't integrate well with other third party applications. A smartphone, on the other hand, has, you can choose what operating system you want to use. And these operating systems, we are very familiar with the OS, Android, all that. We can also run third-party applications. You can install your Gmail, you can install your Yahoo, you can install your Facebook, all that stuff. So that is a smartphone. If you have that, you're good. As the mNutrition project, the tasks that we have around this area of this value chain is one, to train guys who are developing this content for us in those 12 countries that I mentioned. So it's our responsibility to ensure that these guys have the skills and competencies to provide information that the farmer can use. And this information is, basically we are training them on how to do get complex information and transform that into simple information. So you get research outputs, for instance, what we produce here at ILRI, and transform that into a message. So that's a process. That's what we are doing. We want to ensure that they develop content that is safe, factual, relevant, that a farmer can access that information from the language it is used, the technical level of content that is in there, in that kind of, so quality assurance of that content is what ILRI is responsible for within the program, or that is the task or the challenge that we are working on. And we are, for this objective here, we're using local content partners in those countries. So we are going into agreements, not necessarily as ILRI, but within the consortium. We come into a country and get into an agreement with an organization that is locally based, better understands the situation there, and can therefore deliver content. But these are the guys that we are training up there as content teams, so we are not doing it directly. I mentioned we are specifically responsible for these countries. And as the final task is to pass this behavior change information to our John, the farmer, so that typical kind of a person. And we need to focus on what language are we using. It has to be language that John can access in terms of simple language. We have to also focus on the format that we send the content. So for instance, if we put our content on Facebook, are we sure John will be accessing that information? We need to target our farmer with the format of the content. In some countries, you're doing pure voice because literacy levels are so low, you can't do written, or somebody can't read. Technical depth of the content, again, because for consideration. Some of the successes that we've seen is that we have a good training guide around developing content for mobile. So if you want to do, if you have any related project, then that's, we already have that tested. We've already undertook trainings in 8 out of the 12 countries. Sorry, that is a typo here. We have a blended learning courses that we've also brought on board to ensure that we have a complete user experience for our learners. We have a quality assurance framework that we developed. I mentioned that you need our farmers to be certain that the information they get is correct. We have a framework of ensuring the quality of that content. And it has all these documents there that help you to assure that quality. What are we taking home as ILRI, as an institute, from the program? Or are we just implementing it for the donor? So we have these training resources that we can use across the CG or in any other related program. We have the e-learning course. Again, we can remotely deliver this course. Validated process of breaking down complex information into simple information. So we have a process that we've validated, and so you need, it's a plug and play. You just pick that up and you implement it in your program. We have tools that you need to use, that you can use when you're doing your fact sheets. Very nice tools that you can write on and message templates. So these are tools that you have an opportunity of looking at after the presentation. We'll send all these materials. And then we have the structure of a content. If you're developing content, you need a knowledge bank, for instance, where how do you then store your content? Again, these are lessons that we've drawn and we'll be happy to share. Blended learning is a capacity for the programs that we implement within the institute. And again, tapping into public-private partnerships with mobile network operators, because in all these countries we are doing this, and we are successful at this, and this is a struggle for a lot of developing organizations that deal with development. So this is, again, a take-home for ILRI that we've been successful at. The program is funded by GSMA. GSMA is the GSM Association. GSM, I mentioned earlier, is the Global System for Mobile Communication. They have a global association that sort of represents their interest. In partnership with DFID, they've funded this initiative. And we're implementing the program with these other four organizations. We contribute to what we shared before on ag, nutrition, and health. And we are also under food safety and zoonosis. Thank you very much.